people.
Passenger train 5327 is departing from Moscow, headed to St. Petersburg. Freight train 5309 has departed from Tumen to Kamchatka. Military train 5204 is moving from Sochi station to the naval base. It should go towards the Eastern Bridge.
It usually happens that when people talk about a project like this, they have three basic questions about it. How much does it cost? How much time will it take to build? And when will it break even? I had the exact same but very solid and utterly convincing answer to all three of these questions. I don't know. Obviously, it would be difficult to start any partnership with me when you begin at this kind of starting point. That's why I came to the conclusion that if I wanted to make something, I should only rely on my own abilities. There used to be a factory in St. Petersburg that specialized in making asbestos-based products. Back in the 1990s, I became one of the owners.
Good morning.
Good morning. I was making enough money to be able to afford to travel. I had plenty of time to relax during these trips, but my heart had a burning desire to put this energy to good use. At first, I wanted to create a model of nighttime St. Petersburg. But when you sit down at the table, that's when you really get your appetite. I realized that St. Petersburg wouldn't be enough. It would be too local and too small. It seemed to me that I could try to achieve something bigger. Gradually, it turned into the idea of creating a large-scale model of Russia. If you ask anybody in the streets, 800 meters is an enormous area. In comparison to most apartments that have an average size of 30 to 40 square meters, this is the equivalent of 20 apartments. That's pretty large. When we started installing things and I started making the first layouts, I was shocked that I couldn't fit in the whole country, or even in just a town or district. It frightened me. It bewildered me and knocked me off my feet, like a boxer getting a swift punch to the gut. I understand with certainty that 800 square meters is insignificant. Even 8,000 won't help. Maxime, do you remember what we were going to do here?
We wanted to make a village.
We're carving out a small farming area. Gardens, some sheds, outhouses, a scarecrow.
So you mean to say the farming areas will be partly separated by a facade and a fence?
No, there'll be a fence between them.
Between the houses?
Yes, there'll be a fence between neighbors. Despite the love people have for each other, they've always had fences between their plots.
I wanted to become a doctor, so I could help people. But when I was 8, my parents sent me to art school. That's how everything took off. It's definitely much simpler in real life. You go to a field and sow it, but we've been planting these sunflowers for 5 months. There are over 20,000 of them. I came here October 9, 2011. My friends and I just popped in. When we entered the museum, I was taken aback. I was walking around in a daze. I was fascinated by the scale, the amount of detail, the fact that little cars were running. I couldn't understand how they worked. They even had accidents. I was shocked. It turned out that the team who was working on this was small. I wanted to join too. I happened to be looking for a job at the time. My friends asked me, do you want to work here? And I said, yes. They hauled me into Sergei's office, sat me down in front of him, and I said, I want to work here.
Russia is the largest country in the world, at least in terms of area. That means that if I set the goal of making a model of it at a scale of 1 to 87, I would need to have an area equal in size to a country like Great Britain. At this point, it was extremely hard, really difficult to understand what I had to do. Then I realized that in order to compensate for this, I would have to get rid of some things, leave out certain details, and not add others. We work for 12 to 14 hour shifts a day, but the model itself was being worked on around the clock, day and night. I was practically living there. Above all, I was able to put together a team of top-notch people, which is extremely important. They believed in the project and considered it to be a part of themselves, a part of their lives. Alexei, look, we're going to start putting it on the rails. It has to be placed in such a way that visitors can see it.
When I first came here, the western part of the project was just a frame covered with plywood, you know, a flat table. On the eastern side, they were starting to build the landscape. I was just amazed by the scale of the project. I could see the potential of what might come of all this. I started working here as a model maker, so from the very bottom. Then I was promoted to railway manager. Konstantin, I need another wire. Well, if you compare us to the real country, to the real Russia, I guess I'd probably be something like the Minister of Transportation. In the Ural Mountains, we've got what we call Mission Control, or MC for short. This is the system that controls the whole model. It controls the railways, it regulates vehicle traffic, and it controls the system that changes the time of day from day to night and vice versa.
Locomotive 5332 has arrived in Kamchatka for attachment.
It's on the rails, ready for launch.
In order to have as many different kinds of trains as possible traveling around Russia, we use revolving exchangers. They're all controlled using a computer. Each one of these exchangers can store up to 30 trains. When one train pulls in, another takes off to replace it.
Today we discussed a new scene in a village not far from the northern region. I've already started working on it. Work on any scene starts off by building a landscape characteristic. It might seem like it's easy, but it's actually not at all. You need to create mountains, hills, and various terrains. For example, to my right, we have a winter scene that I spent a whole year working on. This is how it turned out in the end. We had a lot of challenges along the way. Like, for instance, we didn't know how to make snow piles, ice ridges, or snow banks. We had to glue icicles, create transitions from winter to autumn, make different slides, show people playing in snow, put together winter parks, and build a snow-covered piste.
We need to make a sixth switch for Route 26 to make sure that the other parts of the route run properly. All right, let's try installing the switch now. We set directions with the help of switches in order to diversify traffic currents around the model. They're similar to tramway switches. Right now, we're installing precisely the same kind of switch so that we can change the car's directions. Thanks to a postgraduate work assignment after I'd graduated from university, I got a job at a scientific research institute in a top secret lab that worked for the Ministry of Defense. I was involved in developing communication systems for Russia's military defense. When my friends invited me to work on the model as a regular electric engineer, I didn't quite understand what I would be doing at first. Route 17 has a small field. Try pressing button 25. But then Sergei Morozov gave me carte blanche. He took me aside and said, "Vladimir, do whatever you think is the right thing to do." This phrase put me at ease. We'll probably have to change the relay. It's fine now, thanks. The top part of Russia is interesting for everybody. It's picturesque and exciting. But as a technical worker, I'm more interested in what's underneath Russia. I feel at home here. I know everything here. My friends, who I worked with at the top secret research institute, are still working there. They recently asked me to join them, but I've already given my heart to the model. What can be more wonderful than this? The whole thing is a marvel. Sometimes I have this thought, this dream of becoming tiny, 1/86th of my size, and walk around our little Russia here just talking to all these small little people.
Quite often, countries rich in natural resources are the poorest.
Africa's a colony. It's a colony of the big corporations. It's a colony of some of its own leaders who are under the thumbs of the big corporations.
So they have to beg from the World Banks. Development of social programs goes to pay back debts.
Poor countries were drowning under the amount of debt that they had. And so every year they would borrow money. And they would use that same amount of money to pay back old debts.
Can all that money really help? The wages of debt.
We wanted to create a realistic model that would represent life, that would depict life as it really is. In the Far East, for example, the Coast Guard has stopped an illegal vessel and arrested its crew. Over here, some Siberian tigers are prowling on a hunt. On this small riverbank in Siberia, prospectors are sifting for gold. In the taiga, tourists have run across a mother bear and her cubs and received a fright. There's also a reclusive hermit living in the taiga. In the north, scientists have found the remains of a woolly mammoth. In nearby rawhide tents, reindeer herders' wives are preparing dinner. By the way, the houses in northern cities are standing on pillars, not on the ground, just like in real life.
My favorite scene, and a favorite among all our visitors too, is the one in Sochi, where a little boy has stolen a woman's bathing suit. I am painting the ground for a field, vegetable gardens, and a forest. I painted, plant the grass, add different stones and sand, completely at random, without any particular order. The hard part is that I have to take breaks. The day on the model lasts 15 minutes, while night lasts 2 minutes, and it gradually falls from east to west. As soon as you've painted the scene and applied glue, it suddenly gets dark, the glue dries up, and you have to start over again. We'll have a thick forest here, a tree-belt area that separates the village from the railway. I would like to design a scene near the village depicting haymaking. People in the field are harvesting hay, cutting grass. It's an artistic image, an idea, an artistic vision, and not from a single artist, but several. It's our vision, but a lot of people don't understand that. A lot of visitors don't get it.
There are always going to be people who criticize you. Frankly speaking, we are always respectful, understanding and welcoming of any criticism. For example, in our Far East region, there's a military airbase that has combat helicopters sitting on the helipad. One time, a man came up to us. I understand now he must have had some connection to this field. And he said, "Guys, you have a vehicle with number 13 there. There aren't any 13s in aviation." We said, "Thank you," and corrected it the same day. Although very often it's offensive and really just a pity when people start criticizing us without having looked at the model all the way through, they'll say things like, "You have submarines there, so there should be a roasted pig." But we do actually have a cook standing there holding a roasted pig to meet the submarine upon its return. We knew they had this tradition in the Navy and we portrayed it. It's also hard to imagine Russia without its famous wooden architecture. That's why we have showpieces of unique buildings that were made without using a single nail. To be honest, I lost count a long time ago of how many people are currently living in our model of Russia. But I know for sure that the population can be measured in the hundreds of thousands.
Look, the police are making an arrest over there.
The boy in the blue sweater standing near the zoo. Please don't touch the model. After one group visited us, a helicopter's rotor blades were bent. It required a lot of work to restore it. Occasionally, little toy people go missing, or they might be missing a body part like a head or a leg.
We have a specially designed rally where the inhabitants of our model are protesting. They aren't protesting against any political system. Instead, they're protesting against the sometimes terrible treatment they get from visitors who vandalize them. They're standing with picket signs, demanding that people respect them, that they don't touch them or break them.
The difference between our model and European models is that ours is not a railway model. It's a model of our country. The railway is not actually the key component here. It only serves to bring life to the model. If you travel throughout the real Russia by train, it would take you almost a week to do so. But in the model, the train from St. Petersburg to Moscow runs for 15 to 20 minutes at an average speed of 20 centimeters per second. There's an accident on Route 6. Roman, what happened there?
A train has come off the tracks.
We should find out why.
There's something wrong with the switch.
Everything here is just like in real life, and just as in real life, we have accidents. They might happen because of a speck of dust on the tracks. If a dirt particle falls there, it could lead to an accident.
Everything's fine. You can start it.
Let's go.
We've always had a few countermeasures to prevent dirt since the very beginning of this project. We installed special equipment and an incredible amount of various dirt-absorbing carpets. In addition, there's a two-pronged system inside the hall. The first of these measures is that the exhibition hall is pressurized in order to expel dust. The second measure consists of simply repeatedly washing the floors.
I often have to walk on the model's surface and on the water to finish some things. People see me and joke, "Oh, look, it's a giant, it's Gulliver, it's God, the master of Russia."
I really wanted to depict pre-revolutionary times and victory in World War II. I almost immediately came up with an idea of how to do it. We created a huge film studio where they kind of shoot movies, and we've reconstructed it all there. We have a scene of the royal train arriving. On the opposite side, a locomotive is pulling a flatbed loaded with filming equipment. We have massive decorations that demonstrate filming a movie about World War II. Tanks, artillery, soldiers, trenches, explosions. Everything is on display there. The quality of detail is such that you basically can't fully examine these scenes without using binoculars. At the same time, there are people filming a sci-fi movie nearby, which attests to the fact that a lot of contemporary movies are being made in Russia.
How is the UFO being held up? Look, it's not standing on anything.
I'm placing houses, dividing plots, and putting cars in place. Some people have already arrived at their country house, some are still on the way. The houses are very beautiful, they've got carved shutters and extraordinary local residents.
Well, it seems that everything is okay on the whole. Ekaterina, is the little car over there abandoned?
Yes.
Then you better apply a little rust-colored paint. Right now it looks too new. The idea is basically complete. It's a little brighter here, a little simpler there. Ekaterina, I think you've done an excellent job, as usual. Now that I think about all the challenges we faced, the difficulties and complexities, it seemed like we wouldn't be able to do anything with them. But there's a wonderful Russian proverb that comes to mind. The hands do what the eyes fear. And it sums up our experience perfectly. We were definitely scared, but we kept on going. A person would have to be crazy to sign up for this project. Sometimes we can't believe it ourselves that we accomplished all of this.